Welcome to the 194th meeting of the New York Linux Users Group. This is one of our regular monthly meetings here at Bloomberg. Thanks for joining us. Tonight we are going to be hearing an overview of CoreOS by Barak Michener here from CoreOS. I'd like to say how much we appreciate Bloomberg for providing this space and thank everyone who is here for taking the opportunity to come and join us tonight. We have our usual set of requests for all of you before we get going tonight. One, silence your cell phones. Two, do not eat snacks in noisy wrappers. If this means pouring it into a cup, closing it, taking it out of its wrapper, whatever it means, please do it now before the talk gets going. It's very disruptive to your neighbors. And three, please use the mics for questions. We are going to hold questions until the end. You want to do it the other way? Okay, so Barak is going to call certain points, and at those break points, please just come on up. Use the mics during the presentation. He'd like to encourage you to just ask your questions as those points come up, so as much as you can, you know, think up your questions and bring them to him. Our next event is actually going to be a special event. We're going to be having a talk about systemd by its main author, Leonard Pottering, at Facebook on June 29th. What's that? It's okay? I'm sure you do, yeah. I think you guys probably talk to him a lot, right? Cool. And that's going to be, like I said, at Facebook. If you look at the meetup page, you'll I believe the RSVP for that just opens if you want to take a look and if you're interested. That's a smaller space than this, so there's a chance that it will fill up. Let's see. Where was I? Yes. Okay. As we always do, we'd like to thank our regular space sponsor here, Bloomberg, and our other sponsors, past and present, IBM, Canonical, Brandor Group, Google, and O'Reilly Media for their support. In addition, NYLUG would not be able to function without our many volunteers that have helped us greatly over the years and help us now. After the meeting, we would like anyone interested, we would like to encourage you, in fact, to join us for more talk and optionally beer and food at Bloom's Tavern at 208 West 58, East 58th Street. That's between 2nd and 3rd. So if you just head a little bit east from here, it's just on the downtown side of the street. Announcements. Okay, for workshops. The next one is June 30th. Please talk to Rob. Raise your hand, Rob. Oops. Okay, yeah, no, he's not here, but... We have workshops where people go at City College at 138th and Amsterdam. The next one will be June 30th. You can check out the meetup page for that. That's a place to just go and do what you want to do, work on stuff with other people, and try new things, learn, and teach. There are Linux distribution DVDs out there. If you are interested, pick one up. Those are for you to try out if there's a distro that you have not had the time to download or do something with. For instance, you can get a bootable version of one of them from out there. Does anyone in the audience have any announcements that they'd like to give right now? Was that a yes or a hello? All right, yeah, okay, so no announcements. Okay, so quick thing, note that at the end of the presentation there will be trivia questions. Barak will have chosen them. I don't know if you guys are allowed to answer. Okay, they're going to choose the questions. Okay, so, so what will happen is you will be asked to answer them. If you can answer them, you will get a free ebook. We'll go over the rules, or a real book. We will go over the rules again at the end because there's always some confusion there. All right, please welcome Barak Michener with an overview of CoreOS. I'm going to step down here and you have the floor.
Oh dear, all right. This is on? Yeah, all right. Cool. Wow, there it is. Okay. Nice. Hi, everyone. I'm Barak, Barak Michener. I'm. This thing's not working. Damn. I'm having trouble with my slides. All right. I'm a distributed systems engineer at CoreOS. I work on etcd primarily right now. And tonight you were going to hear from Brandon and Jake. They were on the list, I know, but neither of them unfortunately could make it due to last minute phone calls and they had to be on. So it's all me to give a full overview of CoreOS as much as I can. let's start with a simple question, which is, well, what is CoreOS? But how many of you have used CoreOS? Okay. How many of you are interested in CoreOS, know something about it, and are curious? Awesome. Awesome. How many of you are using containers in your deployments and so on? And how many of you are interested in containers and would like to know more about this? Awesome. Okay, cool. This is a perfect audience for this talk. I'm excited. So what is CoreOS? Well, obviously we're at the New York Linux Users Group, so it's Linux, right? That's all it is. There's not much to it. But what, of course, you can run it on cloud providers like Amazon EC2, Google Cloud Platform, OpenStack. You can run it on Rackspace, Bare Metal even. We do a lot with Bare Metal, actually. And why did we decide to build CoreOS? What is the thing we're trying to do that's different from any other distro, right? So Google wrote this paper, you know, the data center as a computer, and talking about sort of warehouse scale machinery, warehouse scale computing, I should say, which is all the pieces that go into making a cluster kind of happen, right? Which is individually you've got, you know, a bunch of servers which are replaceable, ephemeral, can go away and come back and maintain sort of this notion, abstraction, of one computer across multiple. So I saw this tweet from Gabriel Monroy, sharp kid, but he mentioned that, you know, there's this kind of strata of the container ecosystem. He was likening it to the things we know best, which is the OSI model. You know, way back when we came up with this network abstraction, or at least we agreed upon it after some amount of consternation. There was IPX, you might remember, NetBuoy, or anybody out there from way back when. Yeah. and so I actually took that idea and kind of forked it. He had a great idea, let's go with it, which is there's a bunch of layers that kind of make a cluster happen. Everything from the hardware up OS layer, where CoreOS lives and most things live today, cluster consensus, cluster resources, orchestration, containers, and everything that you actually run on them. And this also creates a great way to talk about what we do at CoreOS, because we kind of have a lot of projects in each and every one of these sorts of layers, except for kind of the base and except for kind of the stuff that you actually create. So what about the OS? What are we doing interesting in the OS? And the most interesting thing we're doing is we're kind of trying to reduce the API of the OS. CoreOS is, I think it's 250 megabytes total when you extract it out and install it somewhere. And the notion being that today, right, your standard distro contains a kernel, systemd, LVM, SSH, all the basic components you need. And it also contains, you know, apt-get install, Python, Java, Nginx, all these different things. And, and then your app kind of lives on top of running Python or whatever version of Python you might be using. And we thought, well, what do we actually need? What's the bare minimum that could be sort of called Linux or an OS? And you can shift this over. All that you really need is a couple of basic tools. And by building on top of those, we can then break each of these parts out into what they individually need. All the dependencies that an app needs, if you run LSOF or something, for example, to find out what dependencies it needs, you can sort of containerize these things. This is starting to get where this is going. What this also means is that we can swap out, we can do automatic updates. What's cool about the automatic update system is that because we have such a thin layer of dependencies, there's not much that, everything that an application needs comes with it. So everything in the kernel layer that we can keep up to date automatically for you. We do this with, in the most, you know, sort of straightforward way possible. Your data lives on the data partition, and A and B are read-only OS partitions, where an update comes in, we make sure it synchronizes, we load almost DD straight across a image of the newest version of the OS onto the other partition, and then reboot, and sure enough, yeah, you're running the latest things, your data is maintained, your data can't mess with the OS because it's read-only, or at least this is done at a very low level such that it's hard to mess with it. And we do this on the API level via something called Omaha, which some of you may know better as the protocol by which Chrome OS does its updates. So that's kind of what we're doing. When you do an update, this is what CoreOS Enterprise Linux update looks like, which is downloading various versions and keeping track of which versions are running, whether you're on alpha, beta, or stable. I think this may be an older slide, but that's OK. And so yeah, the OS kind of has superpowers. Like, you can do automatic updates. You can have a consistent set of software, which is just this minimal amount across hosts. And the base OS is independent from the app. And so that kind of provides the first level of, you know, everything you need to have an OS kind of work. Here's a good opportunity for questions before I kind of go up the stack a bit. You can kind of see where I'm going. You can obviously save questions or wait until I might get to it later. But if you have any questions, now's a great time. Yeah. Come up to the, yeah.
How do you deal with application that may have specific kernel version dependencies?
How do you deal with if an application has specific kernel dependencies? That's a very good question. The answer is it's really hard to do that exactly. Usually, one thing we do is we make sure that we're running the latest kernel so that the newest and best things can be run on top of the kernel. But if there was some backwards incompatibility or something, that is kind of a little bit out of scope, actually. Any other questions, or should I continue on up the stack? And yeah.
That interface you showed earlier, where is that running?
The interface?
Yeah.
This one?
The
interface. Oh, that's running on, core update is running, I think, on our servers that we're running.
So we have servers that run core update for you.
Servers that run core update for you, and keep going.
And there's also the ability to run it on your local cluster if you so choose. However, we discourage that only because if you run it on our server cluster, you get the updates immediately as opposed to having to do a download to your local machines and then pass those.
Right. Updates. So you can run it on-prem and roll them out as much as you'd like or as quickly as you'd like.
It's an application.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's an application that runs sort of independent on our zone and updates your cluster. You can do it either by yourself or let us take care of it and we'll push out the updates. That's actually another question out there. I'll do maybe like one or two more questions if we have for them. If we don't, that's okay. I'll keep going. If we don't, that's it.
So when you're installing, if you're installing on bare metal or I guess from scratch, are all of the options for like specific file system type, specific different OS level settings that you want, are those available?
Yes. In fact, that's a great question because when you're booting up on bare metal or on a number of cloud providers, there's cloud config, which is the way by which we configure up the OS, partition things, format things, run services. Cloud config file is sort of sent in as extra metadata on like AWS or DigitalOcean, and it's a YAML file that you can set up and it'll execute the services or do the appropriate motions necessary for sort of getting your custom environment or your own little take on it. Copy SSH keys is another thing that you want to do about that time. Something like that. Any other questions? One over there. And then we'll keep going. And feel free to save a question because I'll answer them too.
The OS execution level,
yeah.
You have listed the system DAC groups, jails. What about LXC?
LXC is right in the same wheelhouse, yeah.
It
basically, things that are necessary, like at the kernel level that are there to help you either run or LXC is really kind of, if I'm not mistaken, on top of C groups. Like the C groups are the underlying kernel sort of implementation, and then LXC is on top of that, yeah. So. Yeah. It's about the same level. I would say it's equivalently leveled. Yeah, if that makes sense.
But you don't use it anywhere.
No, because I think systemd is using just C groups directly, but LXC is equivalently on this level, sort of conceptually.
Okay.
If you want to think about it that way, that's a good idea. Yeah. All right. Let's go on. So the next step up, right, is cluster consensus. We want to talk about clustering our applications together into. What will actually become a cluster. What do we need to run on every machine such that we can form a cluster? So what you're trying to do is design for when hosts fail, right? Because we know that these machines are ephemeral. We know that they go away. We know that they may be made out of parts that are consumer parts, the consumer-grade parts that want to go away. That's sort of the whole Google model of availability, and so how do we guarantee that things don't just die? And so etcd, my project, so this is like the part where I go a little bit more into depth because I really like it. And it's sort of, you can think of it as kind of being in the etcd directory, but distributed, or maybe a daemon. Some people just, you know, disagree on what the D stands for. But it's open source. It's a database which is sequentially consistent, and that's an important consistency guarantee, which I'll mention in a bit. Exposed over HTTP, and you know, you can reconfigure it at runtime. You can add nodes, you can move them. You can make sure that your cluster stay, or your etcd cluster stays up. So when I say availability, what do I mean? This is, you know, a kind of diagram of a five-node etcd cluster, of which we have one leader, which is in blue. And they're all talking with each other over the Raft protocol, which I'm mentioning here, but if you want to know more details on it, feel free to ask me later. And say one of them goes away. Well, we're good, because we have still a majority of machines called quorum that make sure that the data that we're receiving on any of the machines will be run through the same state machine, guaranteed by all the different nodes in the cluster, and you know, we're still consistent, we're happy. Another one goes away, same thing, we still have quorum. It's when the last one goes away that we become unavailable, because now we don't know what side of the network partition we may be on. We may have just lost connection across half the machines. They might be progressing on their own. We had no way of knowing that. So instead of doing the wrong thing and accepting writes now, when we know that we're in trouble, we will stop accepting writes. We'll still be able to serve reads as of the last time we knew we were okay. But this is, you know, how we kind of maintain a consistent set of data across all the nodes in the system. So, right, what happens if a leader goes away? Temporarily we go unavailable, and then we do a leader election. That's all part of the Raft protocol as well. A leader is determined, you know, and then suddenly we're back, you know, moving, making progress again. Writes can be accepted, we can keep going forward. And so what does a write system sort of look like? And we think about it in terms of being a log, where each log has entries, entries have indices, and sequential consistency, which I mentioned earlier, is that operations, and these are usually writes, but reads are also kind of part of it, as you will see, that are executed atomically in the same sequential order on all machines. That means that any write must be at least guaranteed by a majority, and all machines that have are progressing or making progress or accepting writes will see them all in the same order no matter what. And so here's, you know, kind of an example in general, which is we have some key that we've already written at time or at log entry one. We're going to put that our pet is a cat, and then we change it to being a pet is a dog on one of the machines. And this thing gets replicated across the cluster, and this makes sense. So okay, time moves forward, we've changed that key, everybody's happy. Consistency real time, though, back up. If we think about this in terms of real time, we're going to start to run into problems. If we say get, you know, what pet we have at 10 o'clock tonight, and we ask this machine, and it says, you know, you have a dog, and it has not made its replication all the way to, you know, that other machine yet. We say, get pet at 10 o'clock. Well, it says it's cat, and this is an inconsistency. And so what we want to make sure is that we kind of have to stop thinking in real time, if that makes sense. Because, you know, 10 milliseconds later, it could actually change, and we'd answer something different. So we start asking about index time, which is we get, you know, pet at index 2 or sometime in the future, and say, okay, it's, you know, dog. The next value of this, or the current value of this, is dog. And then you ask the same machine, and it will actually block until finally it gets replicated, knowing that's coming around, and return only the right thing at the right index time. So a key at an index time is guaranteed. That's the important thing. And that's exactly what the next slide says. Guaranteed that index X, you know, you're always going to have the same result. So you ask, well, you know, how do I know what time it is or what, you know, index it might be right now? And that's why, as quorum gets, this is something we actually have improved a lot in etcd too, that says, you know, I can ask quorum get A, make sure that I have the latest one, whatever that may be. It makes some round trips and makes sure that it has the latest, returns, you know, dog. Now, as it returns that, it may be slightly out of date, right? We can never break the speed of light. There are some constraints that we just can't fix, but quorum git is the most consistent way of being able to do a read that, you know, we have available for you without breaking the speed of light. And I wanted to call out sequential consistency, which I've just described, as being one of the, you know, consistency models. If you've read Afer's posts, his Call Me Maybe series, awesome series, and people often ask about, you know, CP and AP availability, and sort of what's strong CP and what's strong AP and what are these things? And by the way, CP and AP cap theorem. CP being means consistent and partition tolerant, and AP being available and partition tolerant. One says, if you can never choose not partition tolerant because partitions are going to happen beyond your control. You can only choose if you're going to be able to be consistent in the face of a partition or available, accept writes, but maybe you'll have some problem when you come back together again. And what's interesting about this is that these are kind of actually much more fine-grained versions of what sorts of guarantees you can make about each of those sort of categories. If you think about this as being available in green and this being consistent in red, it's a great paper if you want a great blog and a great paper that describes this exact diagram if you want to know more about various levels of database serializability. But at the end of the day, etcd's superpowers allow you to share a consistent configuration data across a group of hosts, resilient to host failures so they can go away. And, you know, we're designing for a consistent view of the world across all the hosts. Now's another great time for questions. I know I did a lot just there, so.
Two questions. One, do you have transactions on etcd?
So, good question. Individual keys are transactions, but in terms of groups of keys or so on, we're designing the V3 API right now. In fact, we've got a prototype of that for ready to go for 3.0. So yes, we'll have full multi-key transactions with, you know, fail cases. So you can do transactions in case some of the transactions fail, and so on and so forth down the tree.
And then on the topic of latency, are you basically saying that etcd and CoreOS fleet could survive worldwide latency? You could have one cluster worldwide?
So the worldwide cluster question is a great question, because usually, we, at least on etcd, we think about this in terms of within a data center and how much latency we have there. There's no reason you couldn't run a raft worldwide with different latency guarantees for sure, because, I mean, talk about the speed of light, you have it, you know, in spades when you're trying to go from one end of the world to another. However, you could set up this, and then there's also multi-raft, which the guys at Cockroach, who are kind of friends of ours, who are working with our raft implementation, are helping us improve. So, and talking about how to actually make worldwide consistency, perhaps with different guarantees, a thing, which would be really nice for some use cases, for sure. Yeah.
Is there a chance to get split brain?
Is there a chance to be split brain? And the answer is no. For exactly the reason that I was outlining, which is that because in order for a write to be accepted, I must have a quorum of the machines agree upon that write. And so if there's a split brain, if there is a partition, and say half of them show up on one half and half show up on the other, unless there's a majority, in which case they know that there's, each individual node knows that it can progress because it's got at least a majority of the available nodes, which means that when the other ones come online, they were never the majority. They will see what happened. They will have not had any new writes and will be able to continue or replay or replicate and then continue on.
Could you go up to the mic if you're going to ask a question?
Yeah.
It's critical for the video people who aren't able to be here. Let me ask a question in the meantime. From the perspective of being able to have serializable consistency, when you are asking as an application what is the state at time n plus 1, you're basically asking for an arbitrary blocking behavior at
yes.
that point, right? And so what is the benefit there versus just saying give me time now rather than time n plus 1?
Giving time now, the way we usually think about it is the quorum get I mentioned earlier, which is to say, give me whatever the cluster thinks in general is latest and do some work to make sure that it's as latest as we can sort of get. Asking at a specific time is never kind of useful because we're not sure what latency conditions could be. We just know that what guarantees we have on the log. So there's a second part to your question I've just blanked on.
It's relating to the acceptance of blocking on the client side while the server waits for a potential update to happen that may or may not be in flight.
It's true. It may not be in flight, and it may actually never come. Suppose you're under a partition at the time, and an update just never comes around. Usually, this is sort of these sorts of things deal with timeouts and so on, which is if you're trying to do like a lock or a master election or something. You make some claim, which is, I'm going to get this at this time, and if that write never comes through, then the timeout happens, and you go into sort of the fail case. But that's generally how that kind of works. Yeah.
So do blocks block, or do writes block until they reach consensus?
Yes.
Or do, okay.
actually, you can write it in such a way that that's not true, but no, I think all writes go through quorum, so yeah. That used to not be true in etcd4, but etcd2 is a much stronger guarantee on that. So yes, writes do block until they have reached consensus.
Because otherwise, I was imagining you would have to handle rollback clauses.
And that's true. You would have to deal with rollback. And that's something that other databases, which are mainly anonymous, don't do as well when they accept writes, right? You want to make sure the guarantees are there. And so yes, etcd2, everything goes through quorum if it's a write. Even etcd didn't do it for a while, right?
I always see this diagram with five.
Sorry?
I always see the diagram with five
demons. You always see,
so what is a good number with, depending on the
So what's a good number of etcd nodes to run? Great. You usually see it with five, and that's because we usually run it with five. Because that allows, you can sort of think about it in terms of almost RAID, right? Which is you have a set of disks or set of nodes, and how many failures can you tolerate and still be okay? Yeah, great. Right, and so because of, so five is what we commonly run, which just supports two failures, right? After you get past about nine, you really start just having diminishing returns, which is to say, any additional machines which would be added to quorum will just add more latency to your sort of state machine of progressing. And so for how much benefit you're getting if four of them were to die at the same time, this is, in some sense, there's some talk about whether it's sort of pets or cattle, I've heard thrown about a lot. And so when you were talking about consistency and cluster consistency, you kind of need to make sure that it happens. And this is the one case, like, based on this, you can then make a lot of other assumptions, which I'm going to go into. But that's kind of where it comes down. So how many failures can you tolerate before you actually, notify somebody in the middle of the night? I don't know. That's a good question. All right, I will keep going. And if you have more etcd questions, that's my thing, so I'm happy to keep going. So then up to cluster resources, what can we build together? And I think about this as being the layer where we have, okay, we now have a consistent set of data that we can guarantee across the cluster. Any node or any member can go check. And so then what do we all have? Like, we have network resources, we have CPU resources, we have, blocks of memory I could have out there. You could think about distributed file systems being in this layer. Or, as the case, what else can we do? In my opinion, personal opinion, you have some notion of sort of, if you ls/dev and think about that in terms of a cluster, like that's what we can now guarantee, right? This is what we're providing between all of us to the layers above. And so the case I like to talk about is flannel, which is, a networking layer between containers that runs on top of a networking layer between machines. So, yo dog, I heard you like LANs. I put your frames in your UDP so you can network where you network. And so, and flannel is there. It's using VXLAN right now, which is a nice kernel module, to provide the ability to create and divvy up an entire IP space. So you have a /8 somewhere, private /8, and you can assign each of these to a container, which is what we kind of eventually want to do with or on layers above us with Kubernetes and so on, is to assign every container its own IP, assign everything. And being able to guarantee that those IPs are unique requires consistency. And being able to guarantee that things are assigned appropriately, or I have this block assigned to me as a machine, goes through consistency, and now I can actually divvy these up and have a consistent view of what my sort of virtual network looks like, which is why flannel is interesting, among other things. partition IP range, speed, avoiding user space. Yeah, I know that one's kind of quick because it's a pretty straightforward thing, which is we have a bunch of resources, and now we can talk about them in a consistent way. Any questions about other things that might live in this layer, flannel itself? I'm not as strong on.
With networking and tunneling over tunneling, performance is the sort of big problem there, right?
Performance is sort of the big problem there. And that's what, VXLAN, which I mentioned, it's a really nice thing because we can avoid user space. We can actually have calls to the kernel, stay in the kernel, copy out appropriately. And it ends up being, in terms of bandwidth, roughly the same, a couple percent loss. And in terms of latency, it affects latency more than it does bandwidth, because after you start to get going, it's not.
So your kernels do provide drivers for that, and
yep.
You actually support
and so we have the latest,
exposing those up to the containers.
And one of the great things about CoreOS is being that we can have the latest kernel with the latest drivers and the latest VXLAN updates for the most speed and the most everything we can. And because we can update the OS underneath all of this, we can kind of keep this whole thing going, which makes flannel faster, which makes everything else faster. It's great. Any other quick questions on this layer before I go up one? Sure.
Is the VXLAN anything similar to MagVLANs?
MagVLANs? I don't know. Oh, MacVLANs.
MacVLANs, yes.
Macintosh.
Because, another way. Most container solutions, what they do is they have... they use Bridge, usually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they use a Bridge.
What I've done is that the kernel also has the MacVLAN. You can create a MacVLAN device, which gives you your own Mac address, which allows your containers to have multiple...
I think it's definitely related to how that works, because I know that each one gets its own IP. I don't know if it gets its own Mac.
Well, get a Mac address so that you can actually request it from the network.
But, at the very least, it's routed appropriately to the container. Mm-hmm. And I think it sets up some host networking on the... outside, I think, but I could be wrong about that.
Yeah, it's available. Usually if you make a Mac VLAN, they're seen about the same level as the hardware device, but they're off of the hardware device, the main hardware device.
Yeah, and usually this is actually kind of encapsulated, so it's probably not the same Mac address, but it might show up as its own Mac address within the VXLAN.
Mac VLANs won't show as the same Mac address.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, thanks.
Cool. All right, I'll go up one, because I'm at half an hour, so I'm not doing too bad. Orchestration. So... we've got all these resources, we've got all these, this consistency, we've got the whole stack going down. Now we need to start talking about kind of what does a operating system for this whole distributed cluster do? And its job is to get work to servers, right? I have some CPU and memory and disk I want to use somewhere. What do I want, what can I put there? What's around? So we want to go from you to the orchestrator API, which runs a scheduler, sets up networking, sets up namespaces for you, and then executes something on a machine somewhere. Because I know I've got all these machines, I can be consistent about where I'm putting it, I'm going to put it somewhere. And so what an orchestrator's job is to do is to try and make sure that I have something I need to run, and people who are thinking containers, yes, we're getting there really shortly. I have something I need to run. It should exist somewhere on a machine I know about. So I know that I want to run, say, 3 of these web server containers. I know I'm running currently 0 of them, so the very simple scheduler, right, is just making sure that, okay, I want to run 3 of these things. I'm only running 2. Well, I'm going to schedule another one, and then I'll schedule another one, and then I'll schedule another one. Oh, I've got too many. I'm going to schedule one below. And so Kubernetes is a great open source project by Google, based on Borg, based on Omega, which is... kind of what we like to use a lot, along with Fleet. Fleet was our early one, but Kubernetes is now the one we're putting a lot of support behind. And this Kubernetes provides the API by which you can say, here's a replication group. I want to run 3 of these things. Do that exact process. And it will manage this for you, set up routes for you, set up networking and namespaces and all this, and execute a container on top of this, on top of your cluster. Right, it looks a little bit like this when you do run it. Like you run a container, like an Nginx, somewhere with one replica on port 80, and it makes sure it gets running somewhere. That 10.2 address is a flannel address, again, made up, again, dependency, to run that pod somewhere on the cluster. And where it actually lands, you don't care. That's actually part of what the scheduler is for, is you just say, here, make sure I'm running these. Go. And so that's... Where's job? There are a lot of things that are doing job scheduling. Fleet's, like I said, an easier one. Mesos is doing things in this space as well. Kubernetes. Swarm is the Docker, you know, equivalent sort of thing. And its goal is to think about app capacity and what you need, take advantage of the resources that came before you, that came underneath you, and of course, it's built on something like etcd to make sure that if something goes down, if I can't see it again, make sure I have a consistent view of the world, because I can do all these tricks with writes and quorum gets to make sure that I'm running three of these things, and maybe one of them went away. And if I know for sure, I can run another one. If I see it come back again, I can, from a partition, I can spin one down and generally control all these running processes. In some sense, again, building an OS up again from the ground up. And in fact, there's a nice like parallel, right? Which is we have the bare metal, the OS, the cluster consensus layer, and we have sort of the bare metal of the cluster, the OS of the cluster, and then we have the next layer up, which is the stuff we're actually caring to run, caring about running. Time for questions on orchestration. I'll take a drink of water.
So given that you're taking the pro-con of VXLAN and to have one big layer two space, mm-hmm. like as far as I know, the real killer feature there is being able to do live migration and keep your IP. That's what everybody in the virtualization space wants to do. So are you supporting any kind of live migration for container yet, and are you planning on it?
So live migration for containers is an interesting question. There's a, I'm trying to remember the acronym, it is something something in user space. Crew, yeah, that's it, CRIU, which is Checkpoint and Restore in User Space, thank you. And which is a bunch of code written to make sure that you can, in theory, take a process or a container, which are actually one and the same, really, when you think about it, right? A C group isolates your process and makes sure that it is, but at the end of the day, it's a PID that you can switch to from the kernel's perspective. And you know, suspend it and resume it and possibly bring back the same IP. That would be a great, you know, end goal. I agree. Does it currently do that? No. Could it, though? That's kind of a great thing where we're going, yeah.
Just any ideas or comments on the overlap or non-overlap between Kubernetes and Mesos?
Overlap and non-overlap of Kubernetes and Mesos. Huh, there's a lot there. thank you, Jerry. I would say that the overlap is such that they are both attempting to do something similar, which is run containers somewhere in a cluster, right? Mesos comes from, actually, Berkeley, if I remember right, and a couple other companies that, you know, sort of took it and ran with it, using Zookeeper kind of as the cluster layer, consensus layer. They're also doing like some amount of, you know, smart allocation, whereas Kubernetes coming out of Google is sort of Google supported and is also like written in Go, lighter weight, uses etcd. It's kind of two different ecosystems, but in similar general sorts of goals and with different sorts of people behind them, theories and about the world. Googlers thinking about things in terms of replication groups and pods, where I'm actually not 100% sure the way about Mesos thinks about it, but
they also came from different foundations. Mesos came from how do we run processes?
Yeah, go to the mic, do it. Yeah, feel free to chime in, yeah, Joey.
Sorry. So Mesos came from a foundation of how do we run processes across the cluster. It wasn't as much focused in on containers. Google, on the other hand, had been working with containers for a decade or more before C groups really ended up in the public sphere. And so Kubernetes was built on the concept of foundationally everything's a container. And another key difference between the two was Kubernetes scheduling is, at the current time, very primitive. Mesos spent a lot of time and effort on building a very powerful scheduling algorithm. And Kubernetes took a different approach, which is, we're going to have a very simpler scheduler with these replication controllers, but we're going to build a nice API so that if you want to do scheduling yourself, you know how to best use your own resources. So you implement your own kind of controllers, let's say. It could be a replication controller derivative, or it could be something that does, you know, the time of the day and picks a machine. It's up to you. And Kubernetes is more about building these individual separable API components and then putting it together into a package that way, giving you the flexibility to kind of say, oh, well, this works for me, but this does not. Mesos is more kind of unified in that sense.
Yeah. I mean, and Kubernetes also has kubelets, which actually run things. We have the replication controllers. You have the API servers. You have a lot of different moving parts.
And you can actually use Mesos to be the scheduler for Kubernetes, and you can run Kubernetes on top of Mesos or vice versa. There's a lot of...
And you can run Mesos on top of all these other things. Mesos is working with etcd as well, so there's that pluggability. There's... Yeah. A whole lot going on right now in this space. And then there's also kind of, what's funny is, I mentioned earlier that, you know, way back there was IPX, there was NetBuoy. There are other ways of looking at a network that were not, you know, as stratified as we kind of all agree upon and is now. And we're kind of in that same space now. Like, this is just kind of my diagram, but some people might consider these two things to be kind of interrelated or be the same thing. And so this is just a more of a mental model than it is a, you know, fiat. So, yeah.
To what extent are you guys more focused on managing a data center versus like a cloud deployment? Because it seems as though a lot of this stuff is more focused on the data center, where you have a cluster of machines and that's it, versus I have, you know, a set of machines that can expand and contract at will. Right?
So funny you should ask that, because I tend to think of it actually as being more of a cloud, you know, sort of thing, which is you can extract it and expand at will. Because we have this consistent view of the world, we know what it is, and so you kind of, your minimum size is maybe about the size of an etcd cluster. But in terms of adding machines that then talk to that, that run the appropriate Kubernetes APIs, replication controllers, kubelets, right? You can spin up more and more of these as you grow, as you see, you know, fit, and then kind of build out your cluster, be it on a cloud platform or bare metal or whatever.
Right, but that's a decision that you make as like a human, as opposed to like deferring to these systems, right? Like expanding
and contracting. Oh, to spin up. Oh, right. Yeah. But again,
so to a certain extent, it is assuming sort of a fixed pool of resources. You've already expended.
Sure. That may change over time. In fact, it should change over time. Right. Some things may die, right?
But through human intervention right now.
But through human intervention right now. But again, you could imagine sort of setting these up a kubelets in an autoscaling group or something if you want to talk in. Yeah, Amazon terms, and it would still kind of work, right?
There's work being done to have
Mike, and there's work being done to have kind of both kind of thing work.
Sorry about that. There's work being done. It's very early on having hooks into the Kubernetes API that you could then hook to a cloud provider, such that you could say, I don't want a set of resources to be finite, but I want it to scale up to a point or down to a point, and then it will in turn recognize, oh, you're running out of, say, RAM, and it'll spawn new machines and then bring them into the cluster. That's very early stage because a lot of this is very in flux right now, and Kubernetes is a still fairly young project, but there's absolutely thought being given in this space to how you could then take it one step further and not have to do any of that manual effort down the road.
Cool. All right. Yeah, I will keep going, and then I'm sure there will be more questions later, too. I'm opening up a whole lot to talk about, so I'm at 40 minutes. I'm doing all right. So containers. Yay, containers. People are using containers. We like containers. Containers are great because, like I said way back then, we can separate out what user land is from what the kernel space is. And so their job is to run an app, isolate apps. And so in my opinion, containers are kind of user space tarballs. Like, there's really nothing fancy to it other than some kernel magic to make sure we have C groups working, and then the appropriate data at the appropriate time. So, you know, we can think about this as sort of lifting your application with, you know, its dependencies, libc, Python, so on, into this other layer on top, which we can then run somewhere and actually execute way down at the bare metal level, or at the metal level, metal being fuzzy. And so you can run it, but more importantly, it's, you know, an isolated pinned one. It's a user namespace, has its own network namespace, perhaps from flannel, but also could be its own bridge controller or something, as was mentioned. Isolated, you know, mount points, isolated resources from C groups, you know, counted resources, so maximum limits and so on. So what we went about doing at CoreOS was writing an app container spec, right? Here's what, you know, we should do, right? Here's what a container looks like, regardless of where it's executed or how it's executed or who's doing some execution of it. Like, let's have an open specification for running applications in containers. And appc is not Rocket. Now, you've probably heard us mention Rocket before, but it's not the same thing. Appc is trying to define a specification for here's what a tarball of user space looks like. And Rocket is kind of in a reference implementation that runs one of these things under systemd. So application containers, self-contained portable, like I mentioned. So why are we doing this? Like, what is it that we really wanted to hammer home within AppC? Well, first of all, we wanted to be open, like an independent organization, independent from us. We have a number of people on the board who are not us now, in fact, the majority. Mesosphere, Google, Red Hat, all getting in, you know, changes and affecting the way we think about containers. Simple but efficient, right? Making it as simple to implement as we can. You know, obviously, we can't make everything perfectly simple, but we do what we can. Secure is a big thing that we really actually care about, is making sure that we can sign and encrypt containers and know that the bits that you're executing somewhere are actually the bits you meant to execute. Being able to verify, you know, things without having any greater like signing authority. You could have just GPG to take a look at a tarball, verify the signature is what it is, and now I know what I'm executing. This is, by the way, not that different from package managers when you really think about it. Right? A package manager does the same trick. But you know, it's an important trick to make sure that you're actually not running some crazy, you know, .ru tarball. So standards based, you know, running using well-known tools like tar and gzip that we all know and love, and they're built into every language under the sun. They're built into every, you know, deployment under the sun. GPG, using HTTP to find things, nothing special, right? But also being able to talk about these things in terms of being a tarball, so we can set up a BitTorrent swarm around this tarball and share it across a cluster. Or, you know, XZ is a different compression mechanism, but it's equivalent here. Composable, so we integrate with things that already exist. It's just not trying to say how you should build them. They just kind of come as tarballs. If you want to talk about building them, we've got Quay sitting right here, and I'm mentioning that in a second. And making sure that it's as OS and architecture agnostic as we can. Things like, why can a tarball not exist for OS X, right? That says, oh, this works here. It should run under an OS X kernel on, you know, AMD 64. Go ahead and run. So AppC components are really just the image format, which is a tarball of a rootfs and a manifest. Manifest tells you if it depends on any other things, what resources it expects, that sort of thing, if it expects any special privileges. Discovery is just using HTTP to find, you know, ask this server, look for some metadata, if it's not just there, and find out where exactly the artifact is, go fetch that. That's discovery in a nutshell. It's nothing fancy. We've been doing this before. And then having some execution environment, which actually can then group these applications together, isolate them, call the C groups, call into systemd, whatever it needs to do, to actually get this thing running. And having a metadata service inside the container, which then can come back out and say, oh, I have, you know, these keys available and so on, rather than trying to just bind mount them in and say, here's a key, you can do something with it. We actually say, okay, here's a service. You know, you can verify the service came from us. You can have a certificate on the HTTP server, which has the metadata. So I can both guarantee that I'm reading data that I believe from people I believe it from, and all the way down the chain. It's trying to get that security aspect all the way into the execution of the container. And then we have a validator to make sure that it complies with the spec. But beyond that, it just makes sure it's a tarball with the appropriate metadata. And we're happy to go. So how are containers created? Well, Quay is the group in New York that does this. From CoreOS, we have, you know, you make a commit to GitHub. GitHub can push to your CI system. CI system can, or Quay, which will also build based on a change, and load it up into your registry, which is some big tarball holder in the sky that you can then pull from. You can then pull from Docker, pull from Rocket, whatever you care. But in general, this is saying, you know, how a container gets built. So you have an application that you're committing code to that gets built through pretty standard tools as we see them today. And then we're running containers. And then hopefully you push some code, and that's how you built the container. And it executes somewhere. It gets orchestrated somewhere in a cluster. It gets flannel pieced in, knows all this because of etcd. It ends up executing under CoreOS and on some hardware that may exist in AWS or on bare metal or something. That's kind of the overview. So by comparison, I'll just revisit today's model, and then I'll open up to questions from everybody and for everything. which is, you know, kind of the way we run it today, right, is we have physical metal, we have the Linux distro of choice, and then we have applications that we have to get install or set up with Chef or whatever it may be. And, you know, when you start out with your model, it ends up being pretty good over time. But over time, these things start to change. And so maybe the latest MySQL doesn't work with the latest OpenSSL, or maybe these things start to, over time, wear and tear. And so kind of thinking about cluster is something that the underlying layer can go down. We can shift that over. That could be shifted over for an update. That could be shifted over for any number of reasons and a network partition, and still be able to, you know, come back up and have a consistent cluster across all of it. So yeah, that's my talk. I'm going to open up to all sorts of questions now, I'm sure. And yay. I know that was a lot. Was that too much? Did I do a job?
Come on up. Come on up, everyone. Question time.
But yeah, plenty of question time, and then there's going to be quizzy questions, hopefully.
Hi. I've been wondering for a while about security with respect to the Docker Zero interface. I know there's no ACLs, at least last I checked. There were no ACLs in etcd.
I checked 2.1 alpha 1 released today. It exists in etcd.
Okay.
2.1 will have them, and so yeah.
Anyway,
yes, it's not. It's a very new thing.
Okay. So I'm. Should we just not worry about it because we're assuming that the container separation is not perfect, and so you should run a separate cluster for separate security?
That's roughly right, yeah. Most people think about it in terms of being sort of open to the world. That's kind of a misnomer, right? That containers themselves aren't very well isolated from each other right now, just because they're not, let's be honest. And right now, hopefully that will change over time. But so mostly we think about it in terms of we have private access to this cluster, and things like ACLs will help actually with sort of multi-tenancy-ish things, even between applications. But
would there maybe be a point in time when there's not necessarily a direct mapping of etcd cluster to CoreOS cluster, so you could have like multiple CoreOS clusters in a single etcd cluster? A single CoreOS cluster with multiple etcd clusters?
Yeah, actually we're right about there right now, which is to say you start up like some etcd cluster. It may not even be on CoreOS, but then you can set up CoreOS to talk to this etcd cluster, and you can have multiple clusters, perhaps through ACLs, talking to a specific, a single etcd, and running multiple etcds on a cluster. It actually happens fairly frequently. This is Kelsey's preferred way of running Kubernetes and then also providing etcd. So that happens a lot, too. So,
okay. Cool.
Both are true, yeah.
Also, I was wondering about some of the differences between Dockerfile versus Rocket, apt-c. Can you build an apt-c, whatever you call it, on top of
image,
another one?
A container image on top of another one?
Yeah.
You can have dependencies, yes. One other thing, like, just to be honest, not have much FUD, as I last said, which is actually Dockerfiles as a build process are kind of useful and interesting. One cool thing that we have with Quay is that you can push a Dockerfile to Quay and then download it as an ACI, if you like. And it will do all the image flattening for you and make sure everything's correct, or and so on and so forth.
Can you locally build a Dockerfile into an ACI?
Yeah, I believe so. There's Docker to ACI, which will allow you to do this. We have a tool. It's open source on CoreOS GitHub. So.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah. You can also pull Docker images straight from Rocket. That's a good point, which is, you know, Rocket will allow you to say, oh, specify this Docker path, and it'll execute it under Rocket from a Docker, whatever.
I was going to ask about Quay versus Docker registry, but it was kind of partially.
If you want to ask about Quay, Docker versus Quay registry, Joey's the right person to answer that question, actually. Yeah.
It's just a comparison. I mean, is it just one is built using this appc versus Dockerfile?
So Quay is, unlike the Docker registry, is actually a multi-container format registry. So right now, as Eric alluded to, you can push Docker images up, and then you can pull down Docker or ACI. Very soon, once ACI and Rocket get support for push, you will also be able to push Rocket and ACI to Quay, and then you'll be able to, in turn, download whatever pushed images you want in either format. So we're going to actually be a true multi-format platform. The bigger differences are just in terms of features and, honestly, in terms of user experience. We put a very high priority on things like security and permissions model. So we have a very fine-grained permissions model. We have a build system that's expanding outward now and does things like caching, which the Docker Hub doesn't currently do. And then our user experience is consistently rated extremely high because we give a lot of thought and effort towards making sure that if you're going to be managing these images that are forming the basis of your application, you need things such as the ability to, you know, audit your actions over time. Or, for example, a feature we launched last month at CoreOS Fest, or a month or two ago, was something called Time Machine, which means every time you push an image to Quay, we will actually keep the previous versions of that tag for, I believe it's a two-week period. And so if you push an image and go, oh, damn, that was not what I need to push, my application's not broken, rather than have to scramble around trying to find the old version, you just go in and go, oh, and move it backwards in time. And now your tag is at that old point. And a lot of these features are built around problems we ourselves have encountered in CoreOS and in Quay. Quay actually deploys itself off of itself, oddly enough. And so over time, as we've been, we were actually one of the very first like fully containerized applications that are deployed. And so we've been dealing with a lot of these problems and building solutions for them over time. So yeah, that's the general overview of the differences.
Yep, cool.
Can you talk a little bit about your choice to base CoreOS on Chrome OS versus Gentoo, which is
itself based on Gentoo,
right? So, or any other of the 1,000 distros out there, how that decision came to be?
It was a decision long in the mists of time. Really, I think the important thing was that it was kind of looking at Chrome OS and the fact that it was based on Gentoo, and we wanted to have. It all started because what we really care about, right, is security. Right? If I've noticed, if there's one sort of theme about all this, it's, you know, Rocket has more security, Quay has more security, CoreOS can self-update and keep things up to date, which is more secure. And that was, in fact, the initial goal, was to sort of secure the web better, right? What if we could have an OS that got all its security patches guaranteed the way we have cell phones do it, the way we have over-the-air updates and everything pushed straight to you? So I think the notion was, hey, how can you do a push OS, you know, push an OS? And kind of the natural fallout was, well, Chrome kind of does that. So, yeah.
Okay, so CoreOS is like thinning down the operating system, mm-hmm. and then you run these containers on top of it.
Yep.
So I guess the logical conclusion of thinning down the operating system is to get rid of it completely. So my question is, how do unikernels fit into all of this?
How do unikernels fit in all of this?
Is this something, like, doesn't that seem like the logical conclusion? And, like, is that, like, a direction you're going, or what?
That seems like a logical enough conclusion, right? Which is to, you know, go all the way, right? Which is, I just need a kernel, right? Or I just need enough of a kernel. And where does that end up? We're kind of holding right now at like kernel plus some of the basic other things we need just to have it, make it easier to start a system, because they're like the number of really sort of usable and also tractable like unikernels out there. I mean, so, and plus Linux runs everything that we know, and so kind of how do we make it work together with everything that currently runs today? Mm. Open questions. It's a perfectly reasonable outlook for the future, but we're kind of sticking at least right now for. With as slim down Linux as we can kind of get away with, and still have cloud config work, and still have mounting points work, still have, you know, container systems like Docker or Rocket both run. Yeah.
An easy one and a hard one. So the easy one, back to metal. Obviously, you have a very thin boot, and has CoreOS specifically addressed like the net boot or boot off of flash model when you're working on
that? Pixie boot. I've definitely run that myself, even on various boxes.
So explicitly supported with your double image rollback and everything.
Yep.
Excellent. And then the harder one, CoreOS versus Rancher. Would you care to say anything interesting here?
The only thing I'll say here, and this is without being too much of one thing or another, which is we like systemd. Even though a lot of people yelled and complained about systemd in very large ways, right, what that gave us was ability to talk to the kernel through systemd, and some of the newer features can be exposed through systemd. If you want to run a different PID1, that's up to you. That's what I'm going to say.
That's a good answer.
So Rancher likes to do Docker's PID1. If you'd like to do that, that's up to you.
I wonder if does CoreOS or any of the utilities that you mentioned as part of these layers also help with the problem of persistent storage when you have to move containers to new servers?
Persistent storage is kind of the real question right now with containers, right? Which is, I know I have a bunch of data that exists somewhere in the cluster, right? How do I get to it? Or I need to have a persistent database that lives on some machine, and it needs to be able to write to disk. I need to be able to fsync. Where can I fsync, right? That's really the question. And so there's a number of sort of half answers to that right now, which is things like people doing running NFS or SANs that they can bind mount in. They have also, like, then there's also some experiments with like Ceph and other distributed file systems that are out there. Heck, I even want to try writing one myself, just to see if I can, kind of. But it's one of these kind of greater unsolved problems that will be solved. Don't get me wrong. We're kind of heading that way, but it's kind of a fun, I don't know, it's open, right? How do you get there? Well, and then this also becomes a question for schedulers and things that are going on right now, which is how can I make sure I run something closest to the data, assume it is distributed, assume I do have a perfectly working distributed file system, should I be able to schedule my application to run right where its data doesn't have to come across the network to it, right? So there's a whole bunch of other opportunities there that remain untouched. That's my answer.
Got a question. How easy is it to run a CoreOS cluster without Quay? Like, if you just wanted to use all open source, is there anything that's missing, or
super
can
easy.
You do everything?
You can do pretty much everything. And if you want to run, so like the whole stack I mentioned, right? Everything in this back up to the picture. Everything in the picture is open source. Like all of it, you can run etcd, you can run flannel, you can run Rocket, you can run all the things from the ground up. Open source, Kubernetes too. And so do you need to run Quay? Not necessarily, though it's free. I mean, we have a free version, right? It's publicly available. It's not free, open source free, but it's free. It's and you can also run things like, well, one of the great things about like app container spec, right, is that it just is an HTTP server. So you can run a local HTTP server, host your image, go find it, go pull it, run it. It works pretty well. You can totally do it with free software, too, if you need to. Oh, and then there's also Docker's open source registry for itself, which if you want to run that, you can do that, too. And then do you need a registry? You probably want one, because that's the easiest way to be able to pull something down and get it going. You could copy it everywhere and do some other back-channel-y things if you want to explore that. But registries are kind of the useful tool here.
You mentioned ECLs in ATCD, and ECLs means identities and authentication. So what can you tell me about how do you do that?
By that, we really go to, so ECLs in etcd, and what's up with ECLs in etcd. And so identities and authentication, right now we're doing authentication, like mostly, and that's why in fact it's called v2/auth, and I just made that change yesterday because it was called security, and I thought auth is really a better name for it. And the reason being that you can create users and roles and set up roles which have different access to different parts of the namespace, and that's really all there is to it. Identity becomes the question of, okay, how else can I become a user, right? Or can this user be verified by some outside you know, authenticator, some sort of token I have. Perhaps it's an OAuth token, perhaps it's something else, right? Right now it's just basic auth, but you know, in the future, I've already left the hooks there so that cooler and more interesting ways of being able to identify yourself as so-and-so or as some role or something can just exist and be all right. But the first step is making sure I can block off things from other people and having that all work well. So.
I have one more question about etcd.
Yeah.
Do you normally recommend running etcd inside of your CoreOS, like the actual OS, or is it more like a service that exists outside of your cluster system?
A little bit of each. It's you run it kind of on your OS. So if you spin up, if you go right now to Amazon and run 5 CoreOS machines, right? And then you spin up etcd on, say, all of them for 5. But at 10 or so, you might want to spin up on, like, 3 of them and make sure you have your little etcd cluster running. Is it, like, an external service that you can talk to at the moment? No, you just kind of want to run your own on top of CoreOS. But that's kind of how that breaks down. Yeah.
Is there a free software reference implementation or some sort of implementation of network service to accept pushes and serve pulls of Rocket or ACI?
ACI, the push spec is being written, and the pull spec, in terms of a reference implementation, if you actually look at the AppC spec, it tells you how discovery works, and you can do it with a combination of like Nginx, an HTTP server, and a file. Like a file to be pushed. So once push kind of gets specified, which is going to be, you can imagine, based on HTTP and here's something I need to push it, it copies it to this web server. So it's an upload, it's nothing.
There will be a reference implementation of push I'm writing.
Okay. So yeah, and he's writing it. So.
And what about server side conversion between Docker and ACI?
So there's Docker to ACI, which is open source, and we give it away. If you were to just say, like, call that, right, on your side, you could definitely do that. So in terms of the conversion, there's no real magic other than we've already kind of written the magic, and here it is. So, I mean, there's some amount of, like, webhooks being able to do this, but in terms of the actual process, yeah.
Since y'all are all about security, do you guys have any thoughts or strategies for credential management and rotation in a big automatically managed cluster?
It's an open thing we're working a lot on right now. Do you have any notions on that? We're working on it, yeah. No, I mean, it's definitely important, right? We have people working on that right now, like back in California, because that's that important, right? We want to make sure that you can actually have authentication and have certificates and have cryptographically secure, like, all the way up, right? We want to be able to say things like, everything from like secure boot, even, right? I have a TPM chip, and I know that the OS that I'm creating is also secure. It's not been modified by whatever container I may have run on it, right? All these are very useful things, trying to get all the way from that sort of certainty up into the container itself. And that requires, as you say, authentication of people and credentials and certificates and the whole nine yards. And so, yeah, we're thinking about it a lot. It's been about an hour. I don't know if I can do one or two, a couple more questions.
Yeah, that's a quick one.
Yeah.
So you guys, I guess you said you're working on it. Is that your own homegrown thing, or are you guys analyzing what's out there? Like, for example, Vault from HashiCorp or something like that.
We,
or if you have looked at that, what's wrong with it? What do you want to add?
I'm probably not the right person to ask about that, but we definitely have looked at Vault from HashiCorp, and it's even pretty nice. Like, we like a lot about it. So. We'll see how that progresses, but you know, at first blush, that's actually kind of a good thing. So, we're.
All right. So that's the end of the question section. Unless anyone has one last, maybe anyone. We're all good. Oh, we have one more. All right.
Yeah. Sure.
I asked. Here you go.
Other than the. Focus on Rocket versus Docker. Are you aware of any differences in philosophy or target user between Project Atomic and CoreOS?
Between Project Atomic and CoreOS? So Project Atomic is using Rocket, if I'm not mistaken, as well. They're using both, yeah, that's fine. There's a lot of similarity in some ways. Atomic's still a little bit TBD. Like, they're still kind of seeing where that fits and where it comes out. I don't know. We'll see. Red Hat saw some of the same stuff that we saw, I guess, is how that works.
All right, then. So we're going to do the trivia right now. I think the way we're doing this is that you guys have selected trivia. Six total, five,
six total,
seven.
One or two.
Six is a good number. And so I think what's going to happen is they're going to ask the question. We'll repeat it.
Yep.
And then we're going to look for whoever. Actually, why don't I do this? Why don't I give you guys one of the mics?
Yeah.
Because the essential thing is I want to try to run around and get everyone in my field of vision so that we can call on whoever gets their hands up first, and you guys can just ask the questions.
Yeah. Go for it.
All right. I'll go first. What is the name of the protocol that's used to update CoreOS underneath the covers?
You in the black shirt in the back there?
Raft?
No, I believe that's
incorrect.
That's
Omaha? Correct.
Omaha.
Okay. So the books are over there. Take a book or one of the O'Reilly ebook vouchers. Next question.
I'll go for one.
Oh, okay.
The current alpha of CoreOS is 709. What does this refer to?
You in the shirt, pinstripe shirt there?
I'll take it. Number of days since the initial release of CoreOS.
All right, come on out.
That day is July 1st or 2nd or something?
So the books and the vouchers are next to the window over there. You see there's a clock counting up just right over there next to where the gentleman is. Next question. That's two now.
Yeah. I have another one. Okay, sure.
All right, you guys ran dry already.
How many nodes, given N nodes, do you need to make sure that you still have quorum in etcd?
White shirt over here.
Given N nodes.
Oh, N nodes?
Yeah.
Sorry. Do you want to take another shot at it?
Yeah. Sure.
Go for it. If you can rejigger it.
N divided by 2 plus 1.
Yeah, there you go.
And in a similar vein, how many nodes after which etcd do you have diminishing returns on the latency?
I didn't quite understand the question, but here you go. If you got it, you got it. 10?
Yeah, fair enough. Nine to 11, right.
Ten
we're forgiving. Go for it.
10 would be too much.
Yeah.
All right. Where are we now? Four?
There's four.
Yeah. Four, yeah.
Let's go for five. Next.
I'm thinking through my own presentation. I know, these guys.
They bailed on you.
You had one job. Do you have any member from?
Why don't we do this challenge to you guys? Pick an acronym and expand it. Take your favorite acronym that you guys work with on a day-to-day basis.
Oh, here's one that you mentioned, right? What is CRU and what does it do?
Okay. Right over here. That's right. Checkpoint restore in user space.
Go for it. That's a good one.
All right.
And what level of consistency was required for etcd? Or that is etcd provided?
Oh, yeah. What's the name of the type of consistency that etcd guarantees? Sequential consistency.
Well, we have to pick on you next time, but no one else raised their hand, so you got it.
Yeah, there you go.
That was it. Just because we've had people like shout out while everyone's hands are going up, it makes things really contentious to try to avoid that. But you were the lone hand, so worked out. All right, everyone, thank you. We're going to be heading over to Bloom's Tavern. That's the end of it. Thank you very much, Barak, and everyone else from CoreOS. If you want a chance to continue the conversation, we're going to be at Bloom's Tavern over on 58th Street. Come join us.